Quest presents an unabridged recording of The Music Makers by Alexandra Walsh, narrated by Emma Gregory. We are the music makers, and we are the dreamers of dreams, wandering by lone sea breakers and sitting by desolate streams, world losers and world forsakers, on whom the pale moon gleams. Yet we are the movers and shakers of the world forever, it seems. From Ode by Arthur O'Shaughnessy, 1844 to 1881. Disclaimer. This book is set in 2020. However, as with all novels, while The Music Makers exists in a world similar to our own, it is not the real world, but an imagined version of events. As such, Sapir Books and myself have made the editorial decision not to include the COVID-19 pandemic in this version of 2020. Instead, I have created a 2020 that might have been. Alexandra Walsh. Prologue. Cardiff, Wales, 1860.
Is she there?
Rosie Hardy pulled open the entrance to the octagonal fortune-telling tent, blinking as her eyes adjusted to the purple-tinged gloom, a reflection from the fabric-draped walls.
Judith!
She called, her voice merging into the folds of night trapped within the flimsy walls.
There's something!
She shouted to her husband, Cornelius, who had voiced the question. Hurrying to her side, Rosie heard his breath coming in short, urgent bursts as he followed her inside. By day, the tent was Rosie's domain, a candle-lit haven of female secrets and promises yet to be fulfilled. But in the midnight shadows of the storm, it was a dank, unprepossessing space. Cornelius held up the lantern, allowing a glow of yellow light to ease the murk. The flickering brightness reached out, illuminating the dim corners, exposing the bundle of patchwork cloth. A child, swaddled in the bright cover, gave a sleepy wail as the light found it.
"Esme," whispered Rosie. "Cornelius, she's left the child."
Darting across the small interior, Rosie reached down to the nest of blankets, gathering it into her arms. Halfway between sleep and wakefulness, the child murmured. Rosie started as something slipped free and fell to the ground, landing with a soft sigh on the grassy floor.
"A doll," whispered Cornelius,
showing it to his wife, who was rocking the child, lulling her back to sleep. The silken dark hair and violet eyes of the doll stared upwards, her face benign, her dress the same as the child's, the two mirror images of the other.
"A doll," echoed Rosie. "All she leaves the child is a doll."
There was a protectiveness in her voice driven by anger.
"It seems appropriate. She always treated the child as a plaything. Esme will be better with us."
Tightening her grip on the slumbering bundle, Rosie hurried from the tent, returning to the bright wooden caravan they called home, leaving her husband to continue the search for the child's missing mother.
"You're safe, Esme,"
she whispered as she snuggled the little girl into the single bed occupied by her toddler son, Jeremiah.
"We will always take care of you."
Esme stirred, sighed, then slipped back into sleep. Sitting in the chair by the small stove, Rosie watched the children, the doll tucked in beside Esme, thinking over the events of the troublesome evening. The child's mother would not return. Of this, Rosie was certain, and from tomorrow, they would announce Esme as their own daughter. A child to replace the one she had lost, the tiny scrap of humanity who had breathed for moments before slipping away. Reaching for her pack of battered tarot cards, she shuffled them, muttering the French names of the Marseille deck.
"Les mains, les battleurs, la papesse."
Well-thumbed and worn, she laid out six cards, her eyes narrowing with each turn. The Empress, the Tower, Death, the Star,
the 9 of cups, and the 10 of coins.
A mother figure, she whispered. Loss of status, dealing with issues beyond your control, forced endings. But there is hope.
She stroked the card of l'étoile, the star.
And there is love and family. Yet things are changing, and where there is good, there is bad, such as it has always been to balance the universe.
Gathering the cards, Rosie glanced again towards the sleeping child.
Which are you, my love?
She murmured, stroking a dark curl away from Esme's cheek.
Are you the good or the bad?
The child did not respond, but outside a roar of thunder caused Rosie Hardy to shudder. Part 1. Pembrokeshire 2020. Chapter 1.
Is this the last?
Eleanor Wilder asked as her father John carried in the small box and positioned it on top of the vast pile in the large airy barn.
Yes, he replied. Everything else is for the annex.
Thanks, Dad,
she said, swallowing hard in order to avoid the croak in her voice. Smiling, her father offered his arm, and after a slight hesitation she took it, leaning on him as they made their way through the boxes to the yard beyond. John slammed and locked the barn door behind them, handing Eleanor the key.
When we've put your pictures on the walls and all the clothes rails and the shelving arrives, it'll be ideal,
he promised, and Eleanor nodded, her face set in an expression of determination.
You're right,
she agreed, as they approached the back of the van, where her brother Aidan, older than her by 2 years, could be heard moving boxes. A blood-red sun was setting in the distance, taking with it the last of the autumnal warmth. Eleanor shivered, pulling her scarf more tightly around her neck.
You go in, said John, nodding towards the farmhouse. Aidan and I will finish this. It won't take us long, and you look exhausted.
Opening her mouth to protest, Eleanor knew there was no point. Her father was right. She was shattered, and the glowing warmth of the fire shining through the window was too much to resist.
Hello, love,
called Eleanor's mother, Anne, as Eleanor walked into the kitchen.
Boxes all in the barn?
It was a cheery, smiling inquiry, but Eleanor felt as though each word was a reminder of her failure. The loss of her beloved vintage emporium in a winding lane off the main high street in Richmond-upon-Thames, Surrey, was the hardest thing to adjust to in the sudden turnaround in her life. As though understanding this, her mother hugged her tightly.
This is temporary, she murmured into Eleanor's red-gold hair. By this time next year, things will be different.
Eleanor resisted the urge to argue, to demand to know how her mother dared make such predictions, but there was no point. This was nobody's fault. It was one of those unfortunate events, a stroke of fate which had hit her and changed everything she had ever known. The past months had seen her forced to make difficult decisions, trusting and hoping things would improve. Collapsing into the rocking chair by the fire in the vast farmhouse kitchen, the flames acted on Eleanor like a spell. As warmth suffused her feet, rising up her legs, she felt the tension of the afternoon easing away. The family cat, Sandy, a fluffy ginger and white ball of curiosity, leapt onto her lap and stared up at Eleanor with knowing amber eyes. He blinked with slow deliberation, watching with his head tilted, as Eleanor replied with an exaggerated blink of her own. This was home, Eleanor reminded herself, as Sandy meowed his approval of her response and curled up on her lap. His purrs vibrated through her as she stroked his silky fur, reminding herself that here she was safe, she was protected, and it was the best place to begin again, to rebuild, surrounded by those she loved. As she closed her eyes, words danced in her imagination.
Safe. Home. Love.
Words she had repeated often, words which on occasion had traction, and she felt them in her heart and soul. Today, however, in the aftermath of watching her life being split between the barn and the annex attached to her parents' farmhouse, it was difficult. The back door opened, and her brother hurried in on a blast of cool evening air.
"Everything's in," said Aidan. "We can sort it out tomorrow. Dad's finishing off a few things outside," he added, addressing Anne. "He'll be about 20 minutes.
"Thanks," said Eleanor, noticing his inclusion of himself in the unpacking. "I'll be fine, though. You need to open the shop."
Aidan laughed.
"It's September. Hardly peak season for a surf shop. Chloe has said she'll open up tomorrow," he added, referring to his fiancée.
"It isn't fair to leave her to do all the work," began Eleanor, but she was interrupted by their mother. "Are you staying for dinner, Aidan?"
"No, I'm going to head off. I'll see you tomorrow."
Eleanor smiled as Aidan scratched Sandy's head before he bent down to squeeze her shoulder in a comforting manner. He hugged Anne and shouted a farewell to John before disappearing into the gathering twilight. Anne handed Eleanor a glass of wine, settling herself in the armchair on the other side of the fire, sipping her own drink.
"Things will feel better when everything is unpacked," she said, her voice encouraging. "I know," Eleanor replied, holding up the wine so it gleamed scarlet in the firelight. "You've been amazing. I'm so grateful."
"Ellie, we don't want you to be grateful," Anne said with a sad smile. "It's a relief. We're here to help you retain some semblance of your normal life. Things are strange and frightening at the moment, but they will improve."
"Yes," said Eleanor, "I know."
Again, the words felt hollow, but she did not want to be perceived as belittling the huge efforts her family had made on her behalf.
"By next week, the barn will be ready and you can reopen your business," Anne continued. "It might not be your beautiful shop, but who knows what might be around the next corner. When the time is right, you might find somewhere even more glorious."
Eleanor forced a smile, unable to speak, but not wanting her mother to think she was unappreciative.
"Anyway, this will give you more time to continue with your historical research," said Anne, as she placed her wine on the small table beside the chair, before returning to the hob to turn down the boiling potatoes. "You might even have time to put together that reference book you've always wanted to write, The History of Theatrical Costumes During the Victorian Era."
Anything historical interested Eleanor. It was what had driven her to open her shop in the first place. It had been her long-held ambition to collate the knowledge she had acquired from her years of dealing with vintage clothing, auctions, and running her business.
"I suppose," she admitted, and Anne laughed at her studied nonchalance. "I might even find time to properly catalogue my collection, too."
Eleanor's vast collection of theatrical programmes was a family legend. Her interest had begun after a visit to a pantomime in London with her godfather, Steve Evans. Dazzled by the glamour, the lights, the sheer spectacle, 8-year-old Eleanor had treasured the programme from the London Palladium. As she had grown older, her interest in theatre, and in particular the costumes and the programmes, had continued. Throughout her teens, Eleanor would trawl auction websites looking for affordable programmes, amassing a collection of several hundred, which she stored on bookshelves in her bedroom, something which the rest of her family, who had very little interest in theatre, found both amusing and fascinating in equal measure. When she was 15, Eleanor had discovered a costume within her budget at an antiques market she had persuaded Anne to take her to. The flowing red dress had graced the corner of her bedroom for months, dramatically arranged on a tailor's dummy, with scarves and beads. It was only when she saw a similar costume online and realised it was worth several hundred pounds, far more than the £25 she had paid, that she sold it, and the beginning of her business was born.
"You could include these," said Anne,
hurrying into the study, which was situated off the kitchen, and returning with a hard-backed envelope. She passed it to Eleanor.
"They're the photographs we lent to your cousin Eddie for his party. They were in my mother's things. She showed them to me a few weeks before she died. I'd never seen them before."
Anne's mother, Alice, had died 10 months earlier. It had been a surprise because her health had seemed robust. Eleanor pulled out the photographs.
"I'd forgotten about these," she said,
examining the collection of faded, sepia-toned images.
"They're Victorian, so they must be Nan's parents and grandparents."
Yes, a few of them are dated, and the genealogists who put together the family trees for Eddie's family reunion at Cliffside managed to identify a few others. There's a rough family tree in there, too. There are more details in the books we were given at the party. A few months before Eleanor became ill, she, Aidan, Anne, and John had been invited to a gathering at Cliffside. Once a family home, the vast rambling property perched on the edge of the cliff was now a clinic specializing in grief counseling. The owners, Edward Stone and his elderly aunt, Caitlin Bathurst, had hosted a large family gathering. Eleanor and Aidan had grown up knowing Edward Stone, so it had been a surprise when Anne had been contacted and told she was distantly related to the Atwater family, who had once owned Cliffside, and who Caitlin and Edward were also descended from.
"How are we connected again?"
asked Eleanor, unfolding the family tree.
"Through Noah Atwater. He married Hannah Blood."
"Blood?"
"It's an old Welsh name," said Anne. "Hannah was the daughter of the Reverend Meredith Blood, who had 7 children. Hannah, who was the second youngest, married Noah Atwater, and we're descended from their eldest daughter, Eleanor."
"That was how I decided on your name," Anne added. "My mother had mentioned a distant relative called Eleanor when I was pregnant with you, and the name stayed with me. When you were born, it suited you."
"Why have you never told me this before?"
"Oh, I don't know. It slipped my mind, I suppose, but when I was contacted about the Cliffside reunion, it came back to me, especially when the researchers sent me the family tree."
Eleanor began sifting through the photographs.
"Do we have a picture of Eleanor?" she asked.
"The small one," Anne pointed. "It isn't very clear, though."
Eleanor held it up, tilting it towards the light. A slim woman wearing a cloven-crowned hat with a flat brim, similar to a man's trilby hat, smiled shyly into the camera. Her dark hair was arranged in a complicated upsweep, while her wide eyes glittered with excitement.
"I love her hat," said Eleanor, "and the detail on her dress is extraordinary."
"There's another one you might like too," said Anne, leaning over and rummaging through the photographs. "This one. The woman looks as though she's wearing a theatrical costume."
"Oh, this is spectacular," Eleanor exclaimed, studying the image. "What an incredible costume. I'd guess at 1870s to 1880s. It's very risque. I believe these were known as French photographs, a euphemism for naughty pictures."
The woman was petite, with a cheeky grin playing across her heart-shaped face, an expression which was at odds with the way her eyes were turned demurely away. Her dress was an incredible confection of peacock feathers, clinging tightly to her impossibly slender figure. But what would have been shocking for the time were her bare arms, legs, and feet. Turning the photograph over, Eleanor was delighted to see faded writing.
"It says Esme Blood. Then the word sister, but it's been crossed out," she read. "Who's Esme Blood?"
As she said the name, a shiver ran down her spine. It was not unpleasant. It felt more like a connection to an old friend, a name she had known but had forgotten. In fact, she was certain she had read the name somewhere before. "She isn't on the Atwater family tree, so perhaps she was a relative of Hannah's," said Anne, looking at the printout.
"Esme Blood,"
murmured Eleanor, turning the name over in her mouth as though it were a fine wine.
"Esme Blood. Why do I know her name?"
Closing her eyes, she tried to remember where she had heard it before.
"It has something to do with tarot cards," she murmured, "but I can't remember."
The back door opened and John arrived with their 2 sheepdogs, Potter and Webby. Anne hurried over to help clean the mud off their paws before they flopped onto their vast squashy beds in front of the fire.
"I can't say it's a name I've heard," Anne said, returning to the conversation as she opened the oven to remove the chicken casserole. "Perhaps you could join one of those family tree websites and see if you can discover more."
"Perhaps," Eleanor said, placing mats and cutlery on the table, wondering why the name seemed so familiar. Eventually dismissing it as something she must have heard at the Cliffside party the previous year.
Chapter 2.
"Your parents have really gone for it," exclaimed Nick Chalmers as he and Eleanor walked around the annex to Anne and John's house that Eleanor was now living in. "It was quite old-fashioned," replied Eleanor as she opened the door to the guest bedroom where Nick would be sleeping. The two-bedroomed cottage was bright and clean, and there was a lingering smell of paint. Eleanor gazed around, impressed with her mother's ability to completely change the space which had been synonymous with her beloved mother, Alice.
"Mum and I loved each other,"
Anne had said the previous evening when she and Eleanor had been making up the spare bed for Nick. "I don't need dubious wallpaper and a green bathroom suite to remember her. She's in my heart. My relief is that we have somewhere safe for you to rebuild your life."
"You look pale," said Nick, scrutinizing her. "Are you feeling all right?"
"Fine," replied Eleanor with a hint of acerbity.
"Liar," laughed Nick. "Why don't you put the kettle on while we men finish bringing in the last pieces of furniture?"
Nick and Eleanor had been friends for years, crossing paths not long after Eleanor had first moved to London. In order to earn money while she tried to establish her vintage emporium, she had signed on with a temping agency, working during the day and building her business online at night. The temporary work had been dull but reliable until the day she was sent to a large insurance company. Dispatched to the basement to photocopy reports with thousands of pages, she had encountered Nick, who was staring at the piles of paper in amusement. It was not long before the two discovered a shared sense of humour and the realisation their ambitions were greater than working in a windowless room for a faceless conglomerate.
"I want to work in magazines," Nick had declared as he changed the printer cartridge on the photocopier for the third time,
while Eleanor sorted the reports into chapters.
"Preferably music, but I'd be happy with an interiors title."
Eleanor had told him about the business she had been running since her teens.
"I sell things," she had said. "Mostly vintage clothes and smaller antiques, jewellery, when I can afford to buy it at antiques fairs and auctions. But my real love is theatrical costumes and programmes, as well as tarot cards. There's a surprising amount of Victorian occult memorabilia around. The Victorians loved a séance."
The following day, when the photocopier had broken for the fifth time and the harassed manager had shouted at them both, they had linked arms and walked out of the building without a word. From the safety of the nearby pub, they had called the temping agency to say the job was unacceptable and had remained friends ever since, briefly sharing a flat before both their fortunes had turned around. Nick had been offered a job at the fashionable men's magazine Axiom, where he was now editor, while Eleanor's luck had changed at a local auction house. An auction lot she had picked up, consisting of hats, had included a selection of bric-a-brac. Inside, Eleanor had discovered a ring with a green stone, surrounded by white heart-shaped brilliants, and several watches in battered leather boxes. Suspecting the ring might be an emerald with diamonds, rather than a silver ring with green stone and glass, as it was described on the inventory, she had it checked by a jeweller friend who confirmed her suspicions. The stones were valuable gems, and the metal was platinum, not silver. The hallmark suggested Cartier in the 1880s. The real find, however, were two leather boxes containing watches, a 1950s women's Rolex set with sapphires and diamonds, and a 1970s men's King Midas Tiger's Eye watch, also a Rolex. Double-checking that the two watches had been included in the original inventory and were definitely her property, Eleanor had approached Christie's auction house in London. The three items were put into specialist sales and 3 months later had earned her the impressive sum of £60,000, more than enough for her to set up her business properly. For the next 5 years, her business had boomed, her life had expanded, and she had loved living in such an historic area. Only moments away were the buildings known as the Wardrobe, the last remains of the Tudor palace that had once stood majestically on the River Thames, the favourite home of Elizabeth I.
A short drive away was the magnificence of Hampton Court, as well as easy access into London. 6 months after she had opened her shop, she had met Robbie Hutchinson, an aspiring musician, and she felt things were set for the rest of her life. It stunned Eleanor to think that in such a short space of time, everything had changed so dramatically. Her problems had begun with a bad cold. Apart from the irritation of having to hire cover for her shop for a few days while she recovered, Eleanor had not given it another thought until 2 weeks later, when she noticed a tingling in her hands and shooting pains in her legs. This was followed by an overwhelming and inexplicable exhaustion, leading to difficulty breathing. With terrifying speed, the tingling and pains had rapidly absorbed her, making it harder and harder for her to move her limbs until she was struggling to walk. The worst point came when she had tried to stand and her legs had crumpled beneath her. Within 2 days of this incident, she had been hospitalized, unable to walk and struggling to breathe, as a creeping paralysis began to shut down her body, including her respiratory system. She was given oxygen to help her breathe, and a week later, she was diagnosed with a rare autoimmune condition, which had been triggered by her cold. It's called chronic inflammatory demyelinating polyneuropathy. Her consultant, Dr. Murphy, had explained, "It's incurable, but it is treatable and controllable. You have a period of recovery ahead of you to rebuild your strength and learn to walk again. There will be difficult days, but you're young, fit, and apart from the CIDP, healthy. So there's no reason why you won't be able to continue with your life nearly as normal. We'll be here to support you and help, literally every step of the way." 3 days later, a relapse had seen her rushed into intensive care, struggling to breathe. When she was released, she had a message from Robbie, stating that he felt this was the right time for them to end their relationship. The stress of her illness, he claimed, was too much for him, and he had his own life and career to consider. When she tried to call him, she found he had blocked her number. This, on top of everything else she was trying to process, sent Eleanor into a downward spiral of depression. She and Robbie had been together for 3 years, and she was staggered by the callousness of his departure. Over the next few months, she had worked with physiotherapists to regain her mobility and was given counselling to help her come to terms with the upheaval which had made her life unrecognisable. Eleanor was 29, and her body, the thing she had always taken for granted, had failed her. What was worse was that she had always taken care of herself. She had never smoked, she ate healthily, she never drank alcohol to excess, and after a childhood growing up surfing and swimming in the sea, as well as helping around the farm, she had always stayed fit, swimming at the outdoor pool in Richmond at least twice a week. Her friends had rallied around, and Nick visited regularly. He and his partner, Giovanni, stepped in to keep her business running, even though it meant taking leave from their own jobs. Her parents and brother had hurried to her side too, and, despite having spent years living in London, she realised the sense in their suggestion that she return to the family home in Pembrokeshire. Robbie's rejection had been the final blow to her hopes. She would be able to pick up the threads of her old life again, but even now, the memory of handing back the keys to her shop brought a lump to her throat.
"You can use the Red Barn as a warehouse and run your business online. There's heating and power in there. You can even set up an office and we can all help," John had said, his face pinched with concern.
"My job is coming to an end in a few months because the shop will be shutting when Gwen retires," Anne had added. She worked part-time for a friend who ran a gift shop. "It'll leave me free to help you."
What had made complete sense was moving into the annex. It was a self-contained, two-bedroomed cottage attached to the rambling family farmhouse. It had once been stables, but had been converted for Eleanor's grandmother, Alice. When Alice had died, the family had pondered over whether or not to convert the property into a holiday let, but its proximity to the farmhouse made them hesitate.
"We'd be on top of holidaymakers," Anne had said. "They wouldn't have any privacy."
The family's procrastination had led to the perfect solution for Eleanor. All on one level, the annex would provide a sanctuary for her to recover and rebuild her shattered life, giving her independence, but with help a footstep away, should it be necessary. Eleanor had made arrangements to move all of the stock from her shop to Pembrokeshire. The kettle boiled, and as she poured the water into the teapot, Eleanor wondered if she would ever return to her old life. Fatigue was her constant companion, and the thought of working the long hours, paying the huge rents, and being responsible for her small staff felt terrifying. But so did the prospect of the loss of the life she had built and the friends she had made. In her heart, she knew there were far worse places to recover and that she was lucky to have a family around her who were doing their utmost to make her life continue as normally as possible. But the fact her body had failed her so utterly and her health remained unpredictable, combined with her regular bouts of hospital treatment, were not things she could easily dismiss.
"Are you okay, love?" Anne called, bringing in two bags of food. "I'll grab the rest from the car."
Unpacking the bags, Eleanor began to put away the food, relieved her mother had offered to visit the supermarket. Shuddering and trying to resist the whisper of self-loathing about not managing to do her own shopping, she breathed deeply, thinking through the coping strategies her counsellor had suggested. This was temporary. One day she would feel strong enough to perform these simple tasks again. It was the small things that had startled her as she adjusted to her new life. Once a lover of busy markets, pushing her way through crowds to secure bargains, she had a shock the first time she and Nick had attended one when she was released from hospital. She had been determined to try and carry on with life as normal, but the jostle and bustle which had once been most of the fun was threatening. Unsteady on her weak legs, she realized the gentlest of nudges could send her to the floor, and moments after they arrived, with her arm firmly through Nick's, she had asked him to take her out of the throng. The uneven pavements were a huge obstacle, the crowds of people, even the distance from the car park to wherever they had chosen to visit, was longer and harder to achieve.
"Stop it,"
she muttered to herself as she opened her new cupboards, looking for places to store things.
"Self-pity won't get you anywhere."
She had left her beloved childhood home to forge her own way in the world, putting down what she thought were solid roots elsewhere. But it appeared the universe had other plans for her, and the ties that bound her to Pembrokeshire had wrenched her home. The sound of a footstep behind her brought her from her reverie, and she turned to see Nick carrying the box containing her tarot collection.
"Where do you want this?"
"Living room," she said. "It's our project for this afternoon."
Nick wandered off and she heard him speaking to her mother. Then he reappeared with the final bags of shopping.
"Here's the tea," Eleanor said, pushing the tray towards him. "I'll sort out the shopping. Then, when everyone is gone, I need to explain our quest."
Chapter 3. An hour later, when the annex was resembling a home rather than a furniture storage area, and her family had left, Eleanor refilled the teapot and returned to the living room where Nick was waiting for her.
"So, what's this about a quest?" he said as Eleanor topped up their cups. "Are we going on an adventure?"
"In a way," she said. "Do you remember before I became ill, I went to a big family reunion at Cliffside?"
Nick was the only person who knew that Eleanor now saw her life in two halves. The time before her illness had wrought havoc, when she had taken her health and mobility for granted, and life after, when her trust in her body's basic abilities had been shattered forever.
"Of course," he replied. "You were interested in tracing your family tree because of the photographs your mum had found in your nan's belongings."
"Well, obviously things have been a bit busy, so I haven't done anything about it, but when Mum showed me the photographs again yesterday, I remembered something."
"What?"
"Last night I was thinking about this woman."
Eleanor pushed the photograph of Esme towards Nick.
"Her name is Esme Blood. I thought she sounded familiar, but I couldn't recall where or why until this morning."
Pausing for dramatic effect, Eleanor glanced at Nick, who rolled his eyes.
"Oh, go on then, amaze me," he said, laughing.
Reaching forward, Eleanor opened the box Nick had brought in from the barn, which contained her tarot collection. Eleanor's fascination with tarot cards had begun when her grandmother, Alice, had given her the first pack. Based around the stories of the Greek myths, she had rapidly committed the tales and the meanings of the cards to memory, but it had taken her many years to learn the nuances and detail of the packs. What had really drawn her interest were the images, the idea of the journey through life these icons represented, and how the cards could offer advice or help her to clarify things if she was unsure about a decision.
"I got these from the last auction we went to before I was ill," she said.
"It was in Kent, wasn't it?"
"Yes. There was the huge antiques market in three large marquees, then the auction in the church hall. I was after the lot that comprised several boxes and a suitcase of vintage clothes. The catalogue said there were costumes, too."
"Was this the one which included the locked trunk?" asked Nick, and Eleanor nodded.
She had fallen in love with the battered Morocco leather chest and had been determined to own it. Fearing the lot would be beyond her budget, she was delighted when no one else had bothered to bid. When her haul had been delivered the following week, to her delight, the boxes had contained more than clothes. There were ornaments, bibelots and postcards from the early 1930s. Prizing open the trunk, prepared for it to be empty, she had discovered some old schoolbooks from the 1970s, various stained cookery books, and a cardboard box labelled Miscellaneous from Grandma. Feeling a small pang of guilt for trawling through someone else's private collections, she had nevertheless ripped open the box to discover several packs of tarot cards, a book on the interpretation of dreams, some handmade cardboard runes, playbills and theatrical programmes, and a series of diaries. The covers on the diaries matched the pattern on the back of one of the tarot packs.
"Last night, when I was getting ready for bed, I remembered why the name Esme Blood was so familiar. It was because I'd read her name in the playbills and on the inside of the diary in the lot we had bought in Kent."
Nick stared at her in astonishment. "How is that possible?"
"Strange things happen," she replied, but when Nick looked unsure, she knew she would have to elucidate. "While I was at the Cliffside party, I spoke to Amelia Prentice, who was hosting the party with Eddie Stone."
"Eddie you snogged at a beach party when you were 16,
Nick clarified, and Eleanor laughed.
"Yes, Eddie, who I snogged at a beach party when I was 16. Anyway, Amelia told me one of her ancestors had called to her, and that was what had drawn her to Cliffside."
"Are you suggesting a ghost spoke to her?"
Nick asked.
"No," said Eleanor, trying to remember Amelia's exact words. "Not a ghost. She referred to it as a connection."
"And a week later, you bought an auction lot containing diaries and playbills belonging to an Esme Blood, who you think might be your relative?"
"It's an unusual name, so I hope it's the same person."
Eleanor knew Nick was sceptical, but she was sure that these items and the photographs were connected. Amelia's words came back to her.
"One of them might call to you."
Is that what Esme was doing? It was odd that the name Esme Blood had found her in two such unexpected ways. Nick began unpacking her tarot collection, arranging the boxes of cards on the floor. Many packs were modern, the images based on Celtic folklore and mythical creatures, but there were some packs which were more unusual. Nick pulled out an early Rider-Waite-Smith deck, which was presented in a carved wooden box. The images on this pack were traditionally the most recognised, although they had been based on the earlier Marseille pack, of which Eleanor had three different versions. Delving further into the box, she lifted out three padded envelopes.
"Here," she said, "these are the diaries."
Nick whistled in appreciation as she extracted the four beautifully decorated books.
and these belonged to Esme Blood, the woman who is in the photograph your gran had in her paperwork.
Weird, isn't it? Said Eleanor.
She picked up the pack of tarot cards that had been in the lot with the diaries and spread them before her. As with so many of the packs she bought, they held a faint, musty smell, a reminder of their age and all they had seen. The fact the ornate black and gold backs matched the covers of the diaries written by Esme Blood seemed conclusive to Eleanor that they had all belonged to her. And as she gazed at them, she felt the usual thrill of excitement a new pack of cards always gave her. Turning the cards, she smiled at the brightness of the colours. While not as vivid as they would have been when they were first created, these were clearer than packs of a similar age that she owned. Dividing the cards into the two packs that made up the whole, she began to lay them out in chronological order to check whether the set was complete, while Nick watched her intently. On one side of the table she placed the Major Arcana, cards that ran from 0, the Fool, to number 21, the World. The ornately decorated icon cards had been the centre of the original game Triumph, for which the deck had been created in Italy. It was a form of trumps, with each card holding a different value. This was a Marseille deck, and as such the names on the Major Arcana were written in French. Le Main, the Fool, began his journey following the path of life with all its many lessons, ending with Le Monde, the World, as he reached completion and understanding. Next to these, she laid the Minor Arcana, the four suits, cups, discs, swords, and wands. The names varied depending on the pack. Discs were sometimes replaced by pentacles or coins, wands by clubs, but the swords and cups usually remained the same. These had court cards, king, queen, knight, and page.
They're in good condition, said Nick.
Especially when you think they're over 100 years old. It's a complete pack, too. Usually there are a few missing.
Are you going to read them?
Maybe, grinned Eleanor. Let's see if they have anything to tell me.
Staring down at the Marseille pack that she hoped had once belonged to Esme Blood, Eleanor allowed her mind to relax, placing herself in the receptive state she used when she was reading the cards. It took a great deal of focus. Since her illness had begun, she had found it difficult to do a full reading as it drained her energy, leaving her exhausted. But as her eyes drifted across the cards, studying the designs, she noticed something unusual. Bringing her focus to the Fool, the card representing every person's journey through life, she realized there were tiny letters written around the edge.
Look, she said, picking up the card. There's writing on it.
Glancing around, she walked over to a bookcase where a few items from her old desk at the shop were sitting, waiting to be found a new home. One was her magnifying glass, the other a jeweler's loop, which she used when checking items at auctions and antique fairs. Holding the Fool under a bright lamp, she read aloud to Nick.
We are the music makers.
Intrigued, Eleanor picked up the next card in the sequence. Le Battleur, or the Magician. Once again, tiny letters were painstakingly written around the edge, this time reading, We are the dreamers of dreams. A shiver ran down her spine. Leaning over, she examined each card in turn. They all had a line of text secreted around the rim.
What the?
She muttered to herself.
You read them out, I'll write them down, Nick said, pulling Eleanor's laptop towards him.
Ready?
Nick nodded, and Eleanor began to dictate the words.
It's a poem,
she said, when they were halfway through.
Do you think Esme Blood wrote it? Asked Nick.
I'm not sure,
she replied, her voice curious. There was something familiar about the words.
May I?
Nick sat back as Eleanor pulled the laptop towards him and flicked open a search engine, typing in the first two lines. A moment later, the poem Ode by Arthur O'Shaughnessy appeared on the screen.
She clicked through to a recording of the poem when it had been set to music by Edward Elgar in 1912.
"Let's examine the cards and check it's the same all the way through," said Nick.
"Why, do you think she might have added her own words?"
"Or a message," said Nick.
Eleanor grinned.
"A message across time,"
she said, her eyes gleaming with excitement. For the next half an hour, they transcribed the poem from the cards before comparing it with the full version. The entire work had been replicated, but 6 cards had been left with no text. Eleanor laid these out in a row. Were they a random selection, or was there, as Nick had suggested, a message in the cards?
"The Empress, Death, the Tower, the Star, the 9 of Cups, and the 10 of Coins," said Eleanor.
Picking up a pen and paper, she wrote down the numbers of the Minor Arcana cards in order to search for supporting cards. It was something she had learned from an experienced tarot reader many years earlier, a way to join the reading together and give it more depth using numerology. Adding the 9 and 10 together, it came to 19, which was the card number for the Sun. Adding the 9 and 1 together, she reached 10, representing the Wheel of Fortune, and finally adding the 1 and 0 to reach 1, the Magician. Glancing at the cards, she made a note of the 3 lines corresponding to these cards. "And we are the dreamers of dreams" was etched around the Magician, while on the Wheel of Fortune was written, "We build up the world's great cities." And finally, the Sun stated, "Can trample kingdoms down." Reading them with as many different inflections as they could, they made no sense.
"Perhaps they were random," suggested Nick. "Not everyone uses numerology, and it may not even have existed when Esme Blood, or whoever it was, wrote the poem on the cards."
"True," agreed Eleanor, "but we are still left with the 6 blank cards."
"What do they mean?" asked Nick.
Staring down at the 6 cards, Eleanor allowed her mind to clear as she studied the images. The elegance of l'Imperatrice, seated on her golden throne with her mace of office, the skeletal figure of La Morte, with his scythe ready for him to harvest souls, La Maison Dieu, with the flames of destruction and the falling people, L'Étoile, one of Eleanor's favourite cards, depicting hope even when the sky is dark, followed by 2 minor arcana cards, the 9 of Cups, or the Wish card, and finally, the 10 of Coins, a significator of family, hearth and home. Staring at them, she began to decipher the meaning of this sextet of cards, while Nick transcribed her words.
"The Empress is a mother figure," she said, "often representing a strong woman, the mother goddess. She offers love and life, the antithesis of the death card. But she can also be manipulative and controlling, although from this reading, I don't think that aspect is the issue. She is here as a representation of the protective spirit at the beginning of the fool's journey, the separation from the mother figure, and the first step into the unknown."
She broke off, her eyes flickering towards Nick.
"Are you writing this down?"
"Yep, and recording it," he replied. "It might be important."
Eleanor felt a rush of gratitude towards him. Nick never questioned her, but always supported and loved her as she did him. They understood each other's idiosyncrasies.
"Death, as I've told you so many times, doesn't mean someone is about to die, but it's an ending, the final chapter in a section of our lives, usually enforced and giving the seeker reason to grieve."
She paused, swallowing hard. When she had been released from hospital, she had laid out her cards, and death had been the first she drew from the pack, followed by a series of cards from the suit of swords, which often presented illness.
"Here, death is with the tower, which echoes the sentiment of the pulling apart of life, lightning ripping through structure, a loss of status through external events over which the seeker has no control. Although this may make the tower card seem destructive, it can also symbolise the surge of energy required to move someone out of a rut or a bad situation.
The moment of having enough of a bad situation, walking away and knowing that while it might seem an insane move, your instinct tells you it's the correct choice. This is supported by the star.
Your favourite card, interjected Nick.
It is, she said, smiling. The glimmer of hope in the darkness, the shimmer of the light in the night sky. Taking your first step away from the mundane into the magical, though it does have a darker side. If you strive for perfection at the cost of your sense of reason, you can destroy delicate hope with despair. But seen as it is placed with the Nine of Cups or the Wish card, the star here is offering true hope, and with it, the hope of true love. Positioned with the Ten of Pentacles, the card of putting down roots, the love of family, there is a positive outcome to these cards.
So, to sum up, said Nick, we have a mother figure who could have been manipulative, a loss of status and enforced changes that led to a new beginning revealing hope, love and family.
Succinctly put, she said, sitting back and staring at the cards.
What do the three extra cards add? The Sun, the Wheel of Fortune and the Magician?
Echoes of the rest of the reading, she replied. The Sun is a positive card. The Wheel of Fortune is ambiguous, representing both good and bad, depending on where you are with the turn of the wheel. And finally, the Magician, often thought to be representative of a spiritual guide, is a messenger, a shadow who accompanies you on your journey through life, connecting you with the elements and guiding you when you reach moments of darkness.
Outside, the moon shone through the window. Night had fallen while they were engrossed in their discoveries.
And the poem? Asked Nick. Do you think it has any significance? It's possible, she replied, reaching for the diaries, the elaborate metallic patterns on the black leather cover gleaming in the autumn moonbeams. If these all belonged to Esme Blood, they must be linked.
Exchanging a look of understanding, the two friends settled on the sofa. Eleanor opened the diary and began to read. Part 2. London, 1875. Chapter 1.
There is little to be said of my birth. I was born and my life began. Only images remain of the time spent with my mother, fleeting glimpses, fragments, ghosts, the scent of flowers created in my mind from the stories told to me by other people. Among those creators of my past were many who suggested my mother's act of abandoning me was one of great sadness. Others would judge it to be a moment of desperation or perhaps cruelty. Over the years, I have viewed it as something different. It was a question of survival. The balance of nature has always pointed to the survival of the fittest, and in me, I believe my mother realized she had met her match. Her departure was her greatest gift. By leaving me in the fortune teller's tent, she bestowed upon me a loving family, a group of people joined by chance rather than blood, allowing me the freedom to be myself, to explore the layers of my existence with no recourse to anyone. Our world, with its beauty, its contrasting darkness and light, its wonder and its challenges offer the adventure of living. To enable us to exist to the limit of our abilities, we have to learn what makes our hearts beat, to be ourselves, and to live truthfully within our own skin. My mother gave me this power. The other thing was my doll, Adelaide.
18-year-old Esmeralda Blood, known to all as Esme, put down her diary and glanced at her lifelong companion. Some might say she was too old for toys, but she would never be parted from Adelaide. The doll, wearing a frothy dress with a gold bodice and white skirt, made from offcuts of the matching adult-sized dress hanging from the screen in the corner, stared down from the shelf in the tiny dressing room. Her hair remained glossy, but her skin was beginning to fade and crack from age and love.
Beginners, 5 minutes.
a young male voice shouted in the corridor, the sound ebbing as he continued through the labyrinthine corridors of the theatre.
"Beginners, 5 minutes!"
Esme glanced at the cheap carriage clock beside Adelaide. It would be 20 minutes before she was needed, but while she had applied her grease paint before embarking on what she grandly thought of as writing her memoirs, being laced into her costume took time. Her dresser, Tilly, would be arriving at any moment. She put her diary into the box under the dressing table. This was where she kept her most treasured possessions, her tarot cards, a letter and the photograph of Aaron. Smiling at the image, she felt a wave of loss and longing. Before pushing the thought from her mind, there was a show to perform. This was not the time for mooning over the past. Esme reached for her black boots, looping golden ribbons around the delicate hooks, ending with a large bow at the midpoint of her calves. Her flowing wrap fell open to reveal the shimmering pink of her loosely fastened corset and underskirts.
"You ready yet, Esme?"
came the cockney vowels of her friend Lynette Mason as she marched into the dressing room.
"Where's Tilly? We ain't got long until we're on."
Lynette was already dressed, resplendent in a costume identical to the golden and white creation waiting for Esme. The dresses were supposed to represent the black, yellow and white stripes of the Russian flag and would be finished with black parasols. The state visit of Tsar Alexander II of Russia was causing a huge amount of interest, and in response, Esme and Lynette had been given a new number to capitalize on the popularity of all things Russian. Both small and dark-haired, the pair were made up to look as alike as possible to enable them to perform a sister act.
"I'm waiting for Tilly," replied Esme, finishing the bow on her boots with a flourish. "Have you seen her?" "She was making eyes at Isaac half an hour ago. I haven't seen either of them since."
The girls exchanged an amused glance. Isaac was one of the young male actors in the troupe, and Tilly had long expressed an interest in his dark, good looks.
"I'll help you,"
said Lynette, as Esme stood, shrugging off her robe.
"Will you read my cards for me later?"
"Of course," replied Esme, stepping into the costume and waiting while Lynette tightened the strings at the back.
"Romantic problems?"
she asked, aware her friend was infatuated with Jeremiah Hardy and was desperate to understand why he continued to show little or no interest in her.
"No, I want to know if someone's going to get rid of Cassie for us."
Esme laughed.
"Why, what's she done now?"
Cassandra Smith was Esme's adopted elder sister. Tall, blue-eyed and with tumbling blonde hair, Cassie was a beauty. Popular for her looks and daring costumes, Cassie was wrongly convinced the catcalls she received every evening were in appreciation of her acting and singing, both of which were, at best, mediocre. However, this did not thwart her ambitions to be the female lead in the touring theatrical company where they all lived and worked. At present, the position was held by Rosie Hardy, Esme and Cassie's adopted mother and wife to the proprietor and actor-manager Cornelius Hardy, who were the biological parents of Jeremiah Hardy.
"She suggested we might like her to join us, to add a bit of gravitas,"
said Lynette, impersonating Cassie's little girl lisp, which she thought made her appear charming.
"Gravitas?" snorted Esme. "Where did she learn that word?" "Probably read it in someone else's review in the Era," replied Lynette, nodding towards the theatrical publication that lay on the chair. "Have you heard her latest, though? She keeps hinting she's met a title." "In her grand plan to catch an earl?"
Cassie was determined to follow in the footsteps of other actresses who had married into the aristocracy.
"You're ready," said Lynette.
Esme walked over to the fogged looking glass in the corner of the room, where she tugged at the front of the dress until it was straight. Lynette joined her, and they checked each other in the glass, ensuring they were as identical as they could manage for their act, the Skylark Sisters. There was a knock on the door, and a woman's voice called,
"5 minutes, Esme. Is Lynette with you?"
"Come in, Winnie. She's here,"
Esme replied, hurrying to open the door. Lynette's mother, Winifred Mason, smiled. Not much taller than Esme and Lynette, with dark hair that was greying at the temples, she was dressed as one of the three witches. The Hardy Theatricals Troupe was a touring company famous for its updated versions.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.